What's going on, everybody? Welcome to another edition of the Reality TV Happy Hour. My name is Jordan Parhar, and as always, I'm here with you live on robhasawebsite.com to talk about some Big Brother. And today, we've got a special preview podcast for you. We're working overtime. Yesterday, we had a live show for you. We got another one for you today. And today, we are doing our annual preseason fantasy draft show. We did one for Survivor Koh Rong. I did another one for Big Brother Canada 4. And now I'm here with the live feed correspondents to do one again. Should be a lot of fun. It's always a good way, I find, to preview the season and to get into everything. Let's go around the horn and introduce your panelists for this evening. First, he's a man who I said I would let him go last in the order, but, you know, I'm changing things up just because we've got a controversial thing to talk about. And that is, you know, he's still dealing with the backlash of the of leaving Cody's blunder off of his top 10 worst moves of all time. It's Taryn Armstrong, ladies and gentlemen. Taryn, how are you?
Well, this is a perfect time to clarify. For anyone that wasn't able to hear me on the last podcast, Cody was on my list. I switched him out for season 9 as a joke to make Jordan get angry. He would be on my list. I will say the hashtag Taryn is right totally dominated. I'm very glad that you created that hashtag. It has made me a very happy man. So
well, we got quite a few Taryn is wrongs though, but it was only directed to me, so I don't think you saw
those, Taryn. I saw all of them. I looked.
Oh, you creeped it. Okay. Dedication right there. And next up, he's a man who we had both these guys arguing against Taryn, but really, he really went to bat today in the Rob Has a Podcast patron group defending why Taryn is wrong. It's Alex Kidwell, ladies and gentlemen. Alex, how are you?
I'm good. Yeah, you miss out on all kinds of great things if you're not in the Facebook group, including tedious debates over pointless, you know, conversations regarding, you know, Big Brother nuance. But that's what we're here to do, talk some Big Brother nuance. So I'm excited. I'm enjoying it. I hope other people are as well.
Yeah, anyone not in the patron group that didn't see that conversation is definitely missing out. So become a patron.
robhasawebsite.com/patron if you want to learn more about that. And last but not least, he's a man who, again, also was very against Taryn for a lot of yesterday. He's usually against Taryn and will probably insult him multiple times tonight, and that's my favorite part of the podcast. It's the great Brent Walgamott, ladies and gentlemen. Brent, how are you?
JP, you say such sweet things.
Well,
no, I love. Yeah, for those of you out there who don't know, I mean, come on, I love Taryn. It's so much fun to make fun of him, though, because he's like, you know, it's like if he seems so perfect, and you just know that there's a chink in there somewhere, and you just want to like show it to the world.
You'll never find it, Brent.
Thank you.
Well, my favorite thing, I messaged Brent privately yesterday. I was editing the podcast after we had recorded it, and I was listening to it. And the part when Taryn put one of Dr. Will's moves as one of his honorable mentions for the worst move of all time, and Brent said that he needs to check his lipstick in the mirror, I thought that was amazing. That was so good, Brent. So I just messaged Brent, and I just said, Brent, I love you, because that was awesome. So, Brent, please bring it tonight.
Thank you.
I'm sure we'll get lots of good stuff out of both of you.
This here for comic relief. Yes.
Yes. All right, so let's set things up for you guys. So we're going to be doing a fantasy draft like we've done before. If you've never been here for one of our fantasy drafts, basically how they work on the Happy Hour is, you know, a lot of these different places or podcasts will do drafts and they'll have point scoring systems and all these things. Honestly, nobody really has time for that. So what we're going to be doing is this is a must-win draft. You have to. We're picking people we think that are going to win the season. If you pick a player that wins, you automatically win. Does not matter how bad the rest of your team does. In terms of the drafting, we've got 4 people here, so we are going to select 1 through 4 in snake style. So it's going to go 1, 2, 3, 4 in the order, and then it's going to go back up 4, 3, 2, 1, and so on and so forth. To set things up for you guys, we have 12 house guests on the so far in the cast, but it's been widely speculated that there are going to be returning players on this season. We're not going to talk about, you know, for those of you who do not want to know anything about who those rumored returning players are, we're going to save our last round as a returning player only round. So we'll give you a bit of a spoiler warning if you don't want to know, you know, who's been rumored to be on this season. It has not been confirmed by CBS. We do not know definitively if that who is on the season, but it has been widely talked about, so we are going to talk about those people, just in case they are hypothetically on this season. So, Taryn, you won our Survivor Co. Wrong Fantasy Draft. It wasn't looking good because, you know, two people, you know, we left off Aubrey and Sydney, two of the, there was two people that did not get picked. They didn't get picked. They ended up finishing in second and fourth, respectively. So it wasn't looking good for us for a while. But Taryn saved the day. He picked Michelle correctly, who ended up winning the season. Sorry, I just spoiled Survivor Co. wrong, if you don't want to know.
I was the original Michelle truther.
That's right.
My Dan Giesling Big Brother 14 strategy paid off.
It really did. So, as a reward, Taryn, we're going to let you pick the order for this draft. And just to set things up for everybody, you know, Taryn could put himself at first. He could put, you know, the rest of us in whatever order he wants. But if he puts himself at first, that means he's picking last in the returning player round. So there is a little bit of strategy to this. And I'm curious, Taryn, to see what order you want to go in. So, Taryn, the floor is yours.
Okay, so I put about as much thought as I had, or as much time as I had into this. I would put Brent first, but he said I had to warn him if I did so. So I'm gonna go Jordan first.
Oh no, I don't want first.
I should have told me.
It's too bad. You won, so it's fine. I'll take
the squeaky wheel gets the grease.
Then I'm gonna go Brent. Then I'm gonna go me, and then I'm gonna go Alex.
Oh, good. When I end up with my pick of the field, I take Darnell Hamilton. So thanks for that.
This is purely strategic.
Purely strategic. Alex, I have a trade to propose to you. Do you want to swap?
Not listening. No, absolutely not. First is devastating for me. I overthink it, and I'm in trouble every time, Jordan.
Oh, geez. Okay, so I have the first pick. I don't really want this. Okay. Whew. Okay, this is hard. I'm going to go with, I guess we'll just get right into it. And while I'm pondering who I'm going to select, I just want to quickly, if you have not signed up for the live feeds yet for Big Brother 18, you can do so by going to robiswebsite.com/livefeeds. Don't forget to do that. You can support Rob's website by doing that. You know what? I'm going to go with, I don't have a pick again until 8. So I'm going to have to take somebody. Like, this is what's so terrible about this, is I don't have a pick again until 8, and then I get, like, I basically am going to have the worst draft ever. Like, there's no chance I'm going to win this draft. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take people that I like. I don't really care about anything, who I think is going to win. I'm just going to take who I like, and we'll see what happens. Because in Survivor, I thought, oh, yeah, I'll pick who I think is going to win. And then that's never worked for me before. So I did finish second, but, you know, whatever. Okay, I'm going to go with somebody who is not, probably not the most fond of you guys, but she is very fond of me. So I love her very much. She is a fellow super fan of Big Brother. I have to put my support behind her. I fell in love the moment I saw her, and I'm even more in love after hearing what she had to say, although kind of against what she was saying about you guys. I'm going to be taking Michelle Meyer.
Michelle, first round pick.
First overall pick, give me Michelle. I want Michelle. I like her the most out of everybody on this season, so I want her on my team. Michelle is somebody, and you know, if you want more, we're not going to get too much into these people's backstories. If you want to know more about the actual cast, you can check out the RHAP BB18 cast preview that all these guys did last week with Rob. But Michelle, she's 23. She's a nutritionist. She's from Michigan. I think if I don't get into this right away, I'll be burying the lead. So we've got some new information that has come out since you guys did that preview show. Alex, do you want to get into that a little bit?
Do you want me to, or do you want to?
Well, I'll give you the floor if you'd like.
Okay.
So,
well, people, as they are wont to do when the cast is released, people begin to dig. You know, there's the you've got your Sherlock Holmes, your Twitter Sherlock Holmes is out there who like to find out and delve into the muck of people's past and see what they can't find about these people now that they're sequestered and safely removed from society. Some interesting stuff comes up every year. Obviously, there's always, a few people who probably should have deleted some old tweets and they didn't, and now it's too late because they're away from those tweets forever, and now people can, post them for all to see. But one thing that people have done is found Michelle's Reddit handle, and she is very active on Big Brother Reddit. She likes to post a lot on there, so we get a lot of insight from some of the things she has to say on there, and one of the things that most prominently came out of that is that she cringes anytime Brent, Taryn, or I speak on these podcasts. But she's right? listening, so that's cool.
Don't forget, she also hates the way Rob says because.
Yeah, and like the one word where he still has a Long Island accent after all this time. The last one.
That's the best part about RHAP, because. So that really confused me, that she said she doesn't like you guys, but she does like me. But I think that has to do with because she watched Big Brother Canada. Like, she's a huge super fan. Like, she's seen... you know, international seasons and stuff like that. And so I dug up some stuff on the Big Brother subreddit, or I didn't dig it up. People sent it to me. That was on the Big Brother subreddit during Big Brother Canada 3. During one of the live episode threads, she said, "I want to marry Jordan." This was when I was still in the house. Another one she said, this one is a little more racy. She says, "I want to take Jordan's V card when he comes out of the house." That's what
wow.
she said.
And then, strong words.
Yeah.
Strong words from Michelle Pfeiffer.
Yeah, and then somebody said something else to her, and you know, there's some confusion about something else. And then she was talking. She said, "Is there a clip of JP's butt? If so, PM it to me." So that was like, I was like, "Whoa, that's a little bit much." But regardless of that stuff, I mean, Michelle is one of the only people this season I could see that is a really it's a huge super fan of the game. I mean, she's clearly somebody who has studied this kind of stuff. She's not as, you know, she's got the super fan mind, but she's not as awkward as Steve or Ian. I know she was saying in her interview, "Oh, well, I'm not really awkward at all." I think she's like still kind of a little bit awkward, but I do think that she will fit in the house. And one other thing is that I don't think, you know, with the Battle of the Block not being on this season, hallelujah, breaking news, that's one other thing we've learned since your preview show. I think that is going to help her early on in the game, because I don't think, unless she gets not targeted right away, I think she can skate by at least until the jury. Brent, what do you think?
I think so. You know, I was really shocked, actually, when she said in the Reddit that she didn't like me or Taryn or Alice. Usually somebody likes one of the three of us.
Yeah,
I mean, usually there's
poison.
A hater. Right, there's usually a hater for me, or there's a few people who hate the other two. Fine, whatever. But there's, you know, usually those people then love the other feeders in return. But no, she hated all of us. We were all in the same boat to her. And so I took that as a badge of honor. I was actually kind of thrilled that someone had enough dislike in them to actually like spend time writing it on a message board to say how much I really dislike these guys. I sort of like, I love that. And I have to say also that if I was cast on Big Brother, because you guys know I auditioned for Big Brother 18, didn't get a call back, fine, we'll look forward to next year. But I shudder to think of all the things that I have written on social media over the last few years, and all the things that the various Sherlock Holmes could dig up on me. So yes, I do believe, aside from all that fun, being serious now, I do think there is a chance that she could go far in the game as long as people aren't threatened by the glasses motif. You know, I think that's a real thing. I think people are threatened by people who wear glasses and who look studious. You know, will the vets look at her like someone, especially once she reveals that she's a super fan, and I find super fans find it very hard to hide the fact that they are super fans. I think that there is a possibility that she could be targeted, especially if she's seen as feisty.
Yeah, I think that's the... I mean, she did say she wants to win competition, so that's one thing that if
as
she gets...
As she can.
Yeah, that is like, ugh. And also, if she sees... I mean, if she sees Tiffany and says, oh, and Polly, and it says, okay, I want to target these people, if she puts her neck out on the line like that, I mean, that might not be so great early on, but I'm going to keep faith in my girl Michelle, and I think that she's just misguided when it comes to you guys. She will come around by the end of the season. Taryn, any final thoughts on Michelle?
I'm so pleased. Like, I was down on Michelle, and then I found this out, and I couldn't be happier. Like,
oh, right. Me too.
I've never been more relevant to the actual show of Big Brother in my entire life. And I have a bunch of people like, oh, your voice is fine. Don't worry about it, Taryn. Like, Everyone's being so nice to me. This right? is like the best thing that has happened.
Taryn, I just thought of something. Taryn, we have the opportunity to have our names said this year on the CBS live feeds. Like, that's possible. She could actually do it. Like, Michelle, girl, come through for me.
it's very cool.
Yeah, it's hilarious, the roller coaster that Michelle has gone on in terms of, like, fandom, because at first everyone was like, she's a Redditor, she's a live feeder, she's just like us, and then they found her Reddit posts, and it was like, oh, she really is a Redditor, this is even better, and then they saw the content of the Reddit posts, and they were like, oh my god, she's the worst person ever existing, and then... And then it got so bad that people kind of turned around again. It was like, she's so much of a train wreck. This is going to be awesome. She's the queen. Yes.
For someone to have that much of an arc before ever entering the house is unprecedented.
Exactly. For those of you who don't know, her Reddit, she did have some posts where she maybe called some people, so a few names that perhaps she would like back, or she maybe fat-shamed a few people. First of all, she's a nutritionist, so far be it from me to criticize her, but... I did love it that she's just someone who puts it all out there. She's such a fan that she has strong reactions to people, positive or negative, and that's what you want for somebody who's a feeder of Big Brother like she is, because she watches the feeds, people.
Yeah, I think she's going to be fun. I think, you know, Brent, you make an interesting point about the nerdy super fan. This year we have no Steve Ian trope. You know, they finally decided, all right, well, if he doesn't keep winning, we're just not going to put that guy in there this year. So instead we have a girl who kind of fits that role. To me, I wonder if the more apt comp might end up being Jason Roy. She's in there. She's a huge fan. She watches all the international versions. She seems very outspoken and opinionated. If she can't rein that in, we could see somebody who knows everything about the game except how to just cool it while they're actually playing it.
Is she just going to sit around in the backyard and smoke the whole time while the game is going on like Jason did?
Oh, these hookers. Oh.
Too soon?
Too soon, Brent. Okay, let's talk about which twin is heavier. You know.
Right. What did he call them? Helga and something else? I forget. Like,
skinny Liz and fat Beth.
Is that what he called the twins?
At one point, because they knew the name Liz, but they thought they were switching in and out, but they didn't know any other name but Liz. So because of that, they were like saying they were both Liz, but they, you know, cut us a one is skinny Liz and the other's fat Beth because they thought she had like an extra pound or two. Like,
and remember Devon called her Chubbums or Thickums?
Thickums. Yes.
Oh my God.
The mountains that are made out of molehills in the Big Brother.
it's glorious. I can't wait for this season to start. Okay. Let's keep things rolling. The first pick is off the board. Brent, the floor is yours. Who is going to be the second overall pick in this draft?
This is easy for me. You know, last year, for those of you who don't know, I won Big Brother 17. We didn't do a draft last year, but I did pick Steve to win, and I have made note of that on many occasions to Rob Sesternino.
Oh, we know.
Yes.
That's only because you cheated and you picked a guy when we did the girls.
And then I went back and I grabbed the audio of that and the video of that and I posted it on Twitter and sent it to Rob. So it was really, really funny. Okay, so I'm going to go with my gut again. My gut is strong. You know, the force is strong on this one. I'm going to go with the guy who I ranked number one in our preseason picks. It's Jose. He is a makeup artist from Los Angeles, California. He describes himself as funny, outgoing, a creative strategist, I'm not even sure what that means, and a visual genius. He does say that his favorite house guest of past Big Brothers was Frankie Grande, because like him, as in Jose, he has drive, nerve, talent, and he's a very strong competitive player. So here's the thing. I can tell you all the reasons why you should pick Jose in your drafts to win Big Brother. But instead of that, I'm just going to tell you to Google the pics of him because anything sent me over the edge, that was it. This man is freaking beautiful. I don't even know how it's possible for someone to look this good. He is possibly one of the most perfect human beings I've ever seen, aside from Taryn Armstrong. And I just think that there's going to be so much fun for him in the house, and I hope that he takes his shirt off a lot. So there's that.
All right, Brent, not holding back. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll throw this to you, Taryn. Jose doesn't really seem like he's familiar with Big Brother at all. So do you think that he can be one of these people that can pick up the game on the fly and actually, make some moves, do some damage in this game? Because to me, I don't know. I'm a little bit skeptical.
I was very low on Jose in the cast preview. However, listening to some of the further interviews, he kind of grew on me. In a different scenario, talking to different people, he really was able to open up and show his personality a little more. And I think that he is pretty personable. And I think that he can do very well. I think that he has the natural social ability to be able to kind of coast for a little while. I don't think he's going to stand out too much. And I think he has the cutthroatedness to kind of pick up the game and like really make some moves. So I think I'm pretty high on Jose. I was hoping that Brent would pick him, but if Brent didn't pick him, I probably would have picked him at some point.
Yeah, I think, no, Taryn makes some really good points about, you know, kind of the stuff that has trickled out now that we've gotten some other interviews, some actual other information to chew on. I mean, God love him, but Big Jeff, not exactly Walter Cronkite when it comes to laying it in the new house guest. So, it's a reminder to not maybe, you know, jump too hard on our first impressions of these people, especially when we put it into the context of, like, who they're having to convey the message of who they are with, which is Jeff.
Yeah, the only danger being, of course, that the interview where he was interviewed by two women, he was fantastic. The interview where he's with Big Jeff, he's kind of reserved. Hopefully that doesn't equate to being in the house not being able to relate to the guys as much.
Right, and that could be a problem with the, you know, the Corys, the sick bro picks guys of the world. Maybe
sick bro picks.
that's Corey's favorite thing.
I know. I can't get over that. It's so
a guy like that, a guy like Victor, seems kind of bro-y. You know, that might be an obstacle for Jose to have to overcome.
Yep.
Brent, what does Jose need to do in order to win this game?
Wow. Oh, what does he need to do? He needs to go to sleep for the first week or so. He needs to then find a couple of girls that he gets along with and maybe another guy or two that he can at least relate to. Perhaps Victor, you know, Rob floated the idea. They are both technically from Puerto Rico originally, I think. I don't know if they were born in Puerto Rico or maybe their parents were.
Heritage,
they've got Puerto Rican roots, right. I think he needs to stay far away from Miss Venezuela herself, Natalie. But because I think that's trouble, Jose. If he can get into an alliance with a couple girls, a couple guys. I know that sounds sort of generic, but he needs to have a little bit of currency in the house in terms of people trust him, and therefore, in a house of snakes, they're looking to keep safe the one person that they know they can trust. As long as he has their trust, I think he'll be okay.
Yeah, I'm seeing a lot of people saying they think Jose equals Raul. I'm not on board with that. I'm going to make that call. I don't think that Jose is anything like Raul.
Yeah, way too soon to even begin to put that level of incompetence on Jose.
Exactly.
Raul from Big Brother Canada 4 for the uninitiated.
Yes.
I think Jose has got some more life experience than Raul, so I think that will also help him as well. And just socially, Jose seems to be fairly with it, especially just from that other interview, not so much from the Big Jeff one, as we discussed. Okay, let's keep things moving along. Two picks are off the board. Taryn, let's hear it. Who is the third overall pick? I'm imagining probably your top person on the board is still there.
Yeah, my top like five people are still there. My strategy worked too well. I should have gone last. all right. It's a tough choice for me because I guess I shouldn't reveal it yet, but I think ultimately I have to go with Tiffany is my choice.
I gamed this draft like crazy, didn't he?
Yes,
he did. He did game it. the strategist himself. Okay, so Tiffany is the pick at three. Taryn, why is Tiffany number one on your board? I know we heard some of it on the preview show on RHAP, but just to reiterate for those who did not have a chance to check that out yet or who have short memories like me.
Yeah, I think that Tiffany is probably the most capable player on the cast. I've watched some clips of her on the Audrey's web series Sequester, where she won. She's very well spoken. She is very good at the kind of thing that her sister was pretty good at. If she can play anything like her sister and be less emotional, I think she has a lot of potential. The danger, of course, is that she's going into this house in a very precarious position. The fact that Vanessa dominated the season last season, and she is exactly like that. She sounds exactly like that. She has the same mannerisms. She looks very similar. She's going to be a huge target going in, especially to these veterans. However, as a sibling player, she is in a position where, as long as she avoids that initial target, she can kind of play in between, because the veterans will be looking to team up with the siblings because they're the closest thing to them, and the new players will still want the siblings as numbers against the veterans, assuming that's what happens. So I think that there's the potential that she can do very well. I think, again, she has the most equity going into the season, but the circumstances aren't very good for her. But I think she has a great shot.
See, for me, that exact reasoning, the being able to play the middle, is why I think that Tiffany might kind of overplay things a little bit, and this might end up getting her in hot water. Alex, where do you lean towards Tiffany? Do you think that she's someone who could burn out quickly? I know you had her high on your initial rankings on that RHAP preview, but some time has passed.
Yeah, I had her first, and I got to tell you, I'm getting flashbacks to last summer when I was all set to make Vanessa Russo my winner pick, and Taryn beat me to it, so I settled for Austin Mattelson. And while the guy wasn't awful, he's no Vanessa. And no, here we go again with. All right, well.
I knew you were my biggest competition, Alex.
I knew as soon as you went third, and as soon as we got to the point where you were about to pick, I'm like, oh, I see what he's doing. He's not gonna let because if he lets Tiffany go here, there's no way she's coming back. I've got two next. So, well done, sir. I really like Tiffany. Obviously, there's the initial red flags are there. They're not going to go away until we see more. You know what I mean? The Vanessa factor is big. The recency of her having just dominated the last season plays. Some of these people may not know who someone is from BB14 if they've only just watched the last season, but they will know Vanessa. The thing is, I really did kind of go and watch some of Audrey's ORG as well after this. I really like what I saw from Tiffany. She seems to have she didn't get Vanessa's degree in game theory, but you could argue Vanessa almost didn't need the level of game theory that she brought to the table. It helped her, but Tiffany has plenty and more to spare. She's a math teacher, not a poker player, so she actually seems to be more social and more capable of relating to the average person, which cannot be understated. That was Vanessa's biggest weakness in her game by far. And then, to top it off, man, watching the sequester stuff, like, I know it's hard to say, like, that you can, translate some of this stuff from a game that was played on webcams. They did a competition where they, like, are forced to stack red solo cups on one hand, and, like, the first person to get to, like, I don't know, so an absurd amount, like, 10 cups, like, end-to-end on the back of their hand won. The other two are just falling left and right. It's like a final three comp, so it's, like, for all the marbles. Tiffany, not only, she gets to like 9 cups and then knocks off her last one. She bends down and picks up the last cup while maintaining the stack of 9 on the back of the other hand. Crazy dexterity, dude. On the level that like not many people demonstrate, on the level that someone like Vanessa demonstrates when she goes on like an HOH type of like serious run. To me, like a lot of these comps are crapshoots, but that's the exact kind of skill that stacks the slightest bit in your favor. I'm really, really liking a lot out of Tiffany. Her only limitation is the connection to her sister. And again, we haven't even talked about the fact that like she may have met people that might be coming back in if she's had opportunities to spend time with them since the season. So not even necessarily that big a weakness.
Interesting stuff. Brent, any final thoughts on Tiffany?
Yes, the thing that worries me the most is that I think human beings as a whole have a tendency to fight the last battle. And there possibly could be people in the house who played with Vanessa last season. And there are obviously some people in the house who have watched last season, who maybe that's one of the few seasons that they have watched. And I think human beings as a whole have a tendency to say, you know what, it's okay if I get beat. I just don't want to get beat by this girl again. And they're going to see her as Vanessa. So as long as she can keep that from happening, I think she's okay. Once people start fighting that last battle, I think the train has left the station then. She's probably gone Because people have a tendency to do things that they otherwise wouldn't do just because they want to get the last word in, so to speak. Like, I could see a returnee saying, you know, well, I may not win the game, but I got rid of Vanessa's sister. You know, like that's some big thing or something. Yeah. And I worry about her from that standpoint. But other than that, I agree with what Alex and Taryn have said.
All right, let's move on to the last pick of the first round. And Alex Kidwell has back-to-back picks, thanks to Taryn giving him that slot. So he doesn't get Tiffany, but he does get two in a row here. So, Alex, who's your first pick?
I really don't want to do it. It breaks my heart. I'm going to go with Pauly.
All right.
So it breaks your heart. So I'm curious. You do not care for Pauly.
I don't, like, you know, I'm not, like, enamored with him as a house guest. I just think the simple fact of the knowledge he'll come into the game with, the, you know, the possibility of knowing returning players, the aura of being blonde Cody, there's a lot to, you know, a lot of upside that he comes into the game. Just, like, to me, it's like starting the Boston Marathon and you give him 5 minutes. You know what I mean? For that reason alone, he's a strong pick.
Yeah, and I'm with you, Alex. I'm not the biggest Pauly fan either, but I like the pick. Brent, what do you think about Pauly? Do you think that, you know, we talked about, or at least Rob talks a lot about on the, you know, the Survivor podcast about perception and how, you know, how you are perceived really can help you in these games. Don't you think that, you know, perhaps because Cody is not perceived as big of a threat as Vanessa is, Pauly will in turn benefit from this more so than Tiffany would?
100%, I agree with that sentiment. He's lucky that Cody was able to at least. You know, people don't respect Cody's game for lack of a better or for better or for worse. I have come to appreciate it more than I did at the time, mainly because I always think I underestimate the social ability of some players, and I think Cody had an amazing social game. But it's true, people don't respect Cody's game as much, and I think if they transpose that onto his brother Pauly, I think Pauly could slide under the radar a little bit. I will say this. I still say what I said to Rob on the initial podcast. I don't want to repeat myself, but I don't know what Rob's not seeing here in terms of Pauly, because Pauly looks like a big ball of fun to me. Like, he looks like whatever Cody was in terms of being bland and a little vanilla and a little boring, Pauly is anything but that. He's got that thick accent. When I watched the interview he did with the two girls from K-Frog, it was just, so there's so much energy in that interview. I don't see any scenario where people are going to be coming for this guy. They're going to want to live with this guy. Seems fun.
Robin Cash sure seems to like him. She tweets pictures, right? Hanging out with him, right? In parking lots and stuff.
Yeah.
Taryn, any final thoughts on Pauly before we go to Alex's next pick?
I think Pauly's a great pick. He was my number two. I considered taking him over Tiffany just because he's kind of the opposite of Tiffany, where his position is so perfect in almost every way. I do not see a scenario where he goes out any time in the first couple of weeks, just because he's set up so well, like so well. The Cody connection, the fact that there are, you know, these potential returning players coming in, the fact that so many of the new players are fans of Derek and want to play with a Cody. He has everything going for him. He only has himself to blame if he messes it up. I think that he's going to go very far in this game and have a very good chance to win. And if he's anything, again, if he's anywhere near as good as Cody, he's probably going to have a very good shot of winning.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, Cody was really good at, you know, making friends with the girls and the guys in the house. And you'd be shocked to see, you know, sick bro pick Corey not want to work with this guy.
And for the record, Alex, you know, if I didn't get screwed over with my pick selection, I would have. Pauly was number one on my board, so there you go. Even though I'm not the biggest Pauly fan, because I don't love the bros every season, but for the reasons you guys laid out, yeah, he's gonna do well. Alex, what's the next pick?
Yeah, that's good. I didn't get my number one, but at least I got somebody's.
You did.
okay. So there's two people I want to pick here. I'm really kind of waffling back and forth. I guess there's really no chance either get back to me. For the sake of not being trapped in onomatopoeia all season, I'm going to go with Zakiya.
Zakiya, okay. So Zakiya is the pick. Why Zakiya? I mean, she was somebody who I really liked Zakiya. I thought that she seemed like a really likable person. She's a fan of the show. She's got a lot of things going on for her. So I think she could do pretty well, right?
Yeah, I mean, Zakiya to me seems like a really strong player. I mean, I think her only limitation is going to be, you know, her ability to make moves and her willingness to kind of like play the strategic game. But I don't think, you know, we've seen a lot of people, you know, flame out early because they're too willing to do that. And I don't think she's going to have a problem with it. I just think, you know, she may, you know, the only drawback is like, will she be able to get cutthroat enough to do this, A, and then B, like, will she be able to, you know, just work with people, you know, in a general setting? I think that she's a big enough of a fan, having watched for as long as she has, that she brings everything to the table we usually, you know, look for when we're talking about, you know, people who have seen this show before. I mean, there's super fans, and then there's, you know, I'm such a super fan. I've loved the last two seasons. They're fantastic. You know what I mean? Like, that's not Zakiya at all. She definitely knows the game, and there's a lot of upside. I mean, she describes, I don't know if she described herself as Jordan Lloyd or said that Jordan's her favorite house guest, but I think the comparison is actually kind of interesting because I could definitely see a scenario where all these big kind of personalities, especially with returning players, are kind of gunning after each other, and kind of Zakiya is able to just kind of sit in the middle, and before you know it, it's Final Five, and she's there with a real shot at winning.
Aaron, do we know how big of a fan exactly Zakiya is? Because I didn't really... It seemed like she was a bigger fan than most of these people, but I wasn't able to get a good grasp on that.
I believe she said she's been watching since season 3.
Right.
I don't think she's much of a feedster person, though.
Okay, so she has been watching the show, so that definitely helps her out. Brent, Taryn, any final thoughts on Zakiya here? I mean,
Alex stole out my next two picks, so he got me back a little bit.
I guess you did a good job going third.
I think Zakiya is a great pick. I wasn't as high on her before, but the more that I see her, the more it's clear that she's very personable. I think, like Alex said, if she can be a Jordan Lloyd who knows the game and can play intentionally instead of kind of just floating along and having things happen to her, that's a very, very dangerous player. I'm a little concerned that she's, you know, very kind of boy crazy, like she wants to get into showmance. That's a little concerning, but apart from that and apart from the YOLO, I think that she's great. I think that she is an amazing pick, and I'm disappointed that I don't have her.
I forgot about that YOLO line and how mad that made you. I was listening to that while I was like leaving my house and going to work, and I was just like, wow, I didn't realize Taryn hates YOLO so much. I'm never saying that in front of him again. Brent, quickly, any potential? Who do you think we could see Zakiya getting in a showmance with?
I've said from the beginning that I think she's going to hook up with Corey. I don't know why. I just see a synergy there that they... Yeah. It seems like she has all the personality that he doesn't, and opposites attract, and that's certainly a possibility for them. I really like this girl. I want her to do well. I just hope that she can keep her mouth shut. She even said during the interviews, you know, like, my mouth can get me into trouble sometimes. Fine, then keep it shut. If you know it gets you into trouble sometimes, keep it shut. And she should do okay. She's just got so much personality. I can't imagine anyone really coming after her. Having said that, this is a game that's played in a house. We often forget this. These people are fine when they're moseying about, going to interviews, this, that, and the other. But when you're living with someone, there's little things that can get on your nerves that you can't even predict in a podcast like this. So I always worry about that during any time I do predictions or drafts, because you just don't know what these people are going to be like living in a house with other people that are similarly minded. So you know, here's hoping for Zakiya. I really like her.
All right. Taryn, here we go. Second pick of the second round. You said that Alex snagged two of the top two on your board, but you mentioned before your first pick that you had your top five still available, top five, baby. So,
well, I was looking at my top five, but half of them are, you know, the other players, so I was actually overestimating.
I see.
Haven't broken that suit yet.
Okay, so Taryn, then who is your pick?
This is a tough one for me. I feel like the top picks are basically gone at this point. I would have picked Jose as well ahead of this person. This is a really risky pick. I'm not sure about him at all. But this is another guy that's kind of impressed me after the first round of interviews. He has a weird confidence to him. He claims that he's not going to be as cocky in the house. He's going to try to be much more laid back. I'm choosing Paul.
Not Poppin' Paul, not Glenn, but Paul or Paulie.
And not Paulie either. Yeah.
Almost went Paulie Paul. I was this close, I got to say.
Yeah, Paul is a really interesting guy. I mean, you look at him and you can say, okay, yeah, that's a guy I could see getting cast on a reality show. He stands out. What in particular, because you said, you know, from watching these interviews, you said that he kind of stood out a little bit more. What was it exactly, Taryn, for you that stood out for Paulie? Or sorry, for Paul. This is going to be so much fun.
One of them has to go.
Yeah, having Paul, Paulie, and a guy that looks like Paul Jackson. Okay.
The only one, the Paul-lander.
Only one, dude. Okay, Taryn. So anyway, back to the question. What stood out about Paul?
Yeah, for me, again, he was very personable in both of his interviews. It's almost too much confidence. I don't want to see him being that confident in the house. That's just going to paint a target on his back. The beard is going to paint a target on his back. The clothes he wears, everything. He's kind of like the risky pick, right? The one that says, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to manipulate everybody. Even though I stand out, even though I'm way, like, you can see me from a mile coming, don't worry, I've got this. Usually those people flame out. I'm looking at you, Nick Juhas. But sometimes they work. Sometimes they succeed. And on the off chance that this guy's going to be good, he's on my team.
Brent, I was going to want to ask you this. For me, I feel like Paul is a guy who, you know, like Taryn was saying, he's a classic guy who looks good on paper in the preseason, but he's just going to crash and burn. What needs to happen for this guy to win? Like, I just looking at this, for me, I feel like he's just not going to be able. I feel like he's going to blow up on someone or something. Like, he kind of reminds me of Zach Rantz. Did you get any of that vibe?
No, I didn't get a Zach Rantz vibe. I do get the feeling that he's a little bit prissy, for lack of a better word. He seems to care about his look and how he presents himself, and he's got all these rings and this jacket. You know, once you're in the house, that's all gone. You know, nobody cares what you look like on a daily basis. I'm curious as to see what he's like living with as a house guest and how he's interacting with the other people in the house. I like what I see from the interviews, but there does seem to be a little bit of, for lack of a better word, disinterest there, and I hesitate to say that, but it's obvious they probably, you know, went and got this guy locally. Rob informed me that Tarzana is near wherever this is taped, I guess, or cast. Yep. So, you know, that he's a recruit they went out and got for some reason. He's probably going to be cannon fodder. Let's see if he can grow beyond that.
Alex, any final thoughts on Paul?
Yeah, I really wanted to take him with my second pick. I just didn't want this to be the summer of Paul with me having Paulie and Paul and just being stuck in that. I don't want to be shoehorned.
You could have taken Glenn, and you would have just had like the best team of all time.
Best team ever, dude. Best team.
Yeah,
dude.
No, I wasn't ready to put all my Paul's in that basket, Paul. I don't know. I like this guy, though. I mean, and I do think, honestly, that he's kind of like, the reason I picked Austin to win is the same reason I kind of like Paul. You know, like, just because a guy says, I'm going to be the villain, like, there's something about being articulate enough and clever enough and aware enough to recognize the need for, like, tropes and archetypes and characters. Like, some people are going into this not really understanding it's a TV show the way it is. Like, this guy seems to get it on a level that some people don't entering the house. That, to me, if he's a big fan, that speaks to that. But the fact that he really doesn't seem to be speaks instead to me to his ability to, like, just pick up and be aware, pick up on, like, read situations on the fly, which is huge. Like, if he can read this for what it is, and then what's to stop him from doing something similar with the social situations in the house? So I think he could be someone that we could see, like, I would, you know, obviously this is, like, best case scenario kind of upside, but I would love to see him as kind of like, you know, a lone wolf kind of con man in there. Like, I think that's a great archetype if you've got someone in there who's just willing to, like, make every deal but not really honor any of it. You know what I mean? Like, he strikes me as most likely to fill that role. So I like that possibility.
Fill that Manguiza slot. Yeah, that would be fun. I would enjoy that. Brent, let's go to you. Third pick of the second round. Who did you have in mind for this one?
I'm going to do something crazy here. And, you know, I picked Jose because he was first on my list. But I'm going to pick the girl who I had last on my list, Bronte. No! I can't even say her last name. Somebody help.
No! Wow, Bronte.
I'm going to go with her. You know, first of all, there's some other information has come out that we didn't know previously. I remember watching Steve on the feeds last year, and Steve was talking about this girl that he really liked who was in the semifinals or maybe even the finals with a bow in her hair, and he's since confirmed on Twitter that he was indeed talking about Bronte. I am just convinced at this point, and maybe I'm wrong, I'm convinced that a little bit of her shtick is an act just to get on the show. Like somebody I know on this podcast who said he was like a right-wing Republican, and somehow that never came up on Big Brother Canada whatsoever.
No, not once.
Right? I think that there's a good chance that this is an act, it's a shtick. It may be a part of her personality, but I think she's deliberately playing it up to get on the show. I think maybe she feels like she's still in casting mode a little bit, trying to impress everybody. I'm interested to see what she's going to look like once she gets in the house. I'm hopeful that if that voice is still the same, that she can at least not talk so loud sometimes. But, you know, if she does, hopefully they'll find it endearing instead of irritating. I just think that for anybody to go to finals last year to get cut, then come back again this year shows a level of fandom to me that I can truly appreciate, and I want to support her. So, Bronte, I picked you last in my rankings, but now you're my girl.
Yeah, and some other information that came out was that Bronte's name surfaced on some model website. Alex Tarrant, did you guys see that?
Acting website.
I did see
that.
Yeah, so I mean that, and then it shows, and from her LinkedIn, I think it says, like, she said in her interview with Big Jeff that she is a math student and all this stuff, and I believe that's true, but before she did, you know, theater school and all this other stuff. So, I mean, that's not, yeah, I'm with you, Brent. I think she's definitely is playing up a lot of these aspects, and especially the what's 9 times 9. And
oh, yeah,
she got
come
that.
On.
But, like,
come
she
on.
Did not, she did, obviously, she did not get that. She got that wrong on purpose. Like, come on. So,
right.
So I'm with you. Alex, what do you think about Bronte's idea about showmances? She said that she doesn't want to have any showmances, and she wants to push them onto other people. I personally really like that idea.
Yeah, well, that's what Vanessa spoke about trying to do and executed with Clay and Shelley. I don't know if we remember how like adamant she was about like now you two come together and kiss, but she really was pushing that. You know what I mean? Like that was an element of her game that I think was not only understated but valuable, because when time came she was able to push them out in front as, look, this couple is just as guilty and there's two of them. You know what I mean? So Clay and Shelley were, you know, the fall guys for her. So that has value. You create that early in the game and then it becomes currency that you can spend late in the game. You know what I mean? Yeah, I think there's a lot to like from Bronte. I think it's very easy to see the initial assessment and hear, hi, hello, I'm Bronte, and just be like, done. I'll just write this girl off. You know what I mean? That is like the knee-jerk reaction. But then, when you really listen to it, she makes no hesitation. She wants to be hated and win. You know what I mean? She answers all the questions the way you'd want them to be answered. I think she's going to be good at the game. It's just a classic bell curve. If she can overcome the first impression, look out.
Bronte said that when she wants people to remember her as the female Derek Taron. The last person to say that was, or at least something similar to that, was LaVita in Big Brother Canada 4. Who's going to do better, Bronte this season or LaVita, Big Brother Canada 4, who I believe came in, I want to say, 11th place?
I mean, Bronte's going to do better. I mean, even if she goes out earlier, she's probably going to do better. So let's be fair. Yeah, I gambled with my heart here, and it got stolen away with Brent stole it away. I love Bronte. Yeah, people are finally jumping on the Bronte train. I was here first. I'm the conductor. she's awesome. I think she has the potential to do really well. The thing that scares me about her is that she's not super familiar with the show, and that could get her in trouble. I think that, you know, being the kind of character that she is, it's very beneficial to know a lot about the show because you can make a lot of moves that are going to subtly help you along the way. She's not going to know those things. However, I still think that just her overall character, she's not going to be targeted for a long time, I don't think, unless she really just stands out and she's really not who we think she is. I'm really going to be rooting for her, even though she's not on my team. I love anyone who loves science. Go Bronte.
I have to say, I have another football reference.
Yes.
Like, She is who we thought she was.
Yes. There you go.
But will they let her off the hook?
Right? Will they let her off the hook?
Let her off the hook. Oh, my God. I have to say, if you guys haven't listened to our rankings podcast, when we talked about Bronte, Rob played the little bit where Jeff was like, tell everybody your name and where you're from. She was like, hello, everybody. My name is Bronte. It was like the best moment of the podcast.
Listen to that like 7 times.
Rob fell off his chair. It was so glorious. I loved it.
Yeah, it was pretty great. Definitely check that out, robisawebsite.com. Okay, so let's keep things rolling. I've got back-to-back picks here. In such a horrific draft slot. I mean,
right?
Now I have to take two of these people, and then I have the last pick of the returning player round. So, geez. Again, I think I'm just going to pick who I like here.
Thank you.
Out of these people. So, first, I'm going to take this guy. I mean, it was destiny that I would end up with this man here. He's a dog groomer, which, first of all, like, amazing, yet he's like this overweight, pudgy guy who used to be a cop and has a very thick New York accent. He looks like Paul Jackson, dude. He might not be as insane, but put him on my team. It's Glenn Garcia. Glenn is going to be my pick. I have a very strong feeling that Glenn will be out within the first 3 weeks. But I think it's going to be a very fun ride. I think Glenn has the potential this season to be Big Brother 18's version of Devin. Taryn, what do you think about that? Could we see, you know, he has a daughter. I could see him going all over the place. I feel like this guy's going to be Feeds Gold.
Yeah, I think so. I think that he was not cast to be one of the Derek types. I think that he was cast to be a Devin. I think that he is not going to fit in very well with this cast. And he's going to have all sorts of ideas about how to play the game. He's talking about, like, in multiple interviews now, he's talked about, yeah, I have a fiance, but I'm still going to flirt around, you know, do whatever's necessary. Like, he's so in love with the idea of doing everything it takes that he's going to preemptively do more than it takes, and he's going to get himself into a lot of trouble, and I think it's going to be fun to watch.
Yeah, it's going to be great. I can't wait. I can't wait, dude. Alex, I mean, this guy also, though, I mean, underreported, but this guy was a cop before, right? So I feel like some of those skills, at least some of them, have to translate to this game, right? I mean, Derek was so good.
Could he potentially be Big Brother's version of Tony Vlachos? Is that the upside? Hey, look, I'm not a cop. I know, like, my casting video said a cop, but a construction worker. Tiles. I work at Tiles.
Oh, man. Oh, it's just going to be so great. And very good point by Taryn that, yes, Kathy from BB12 was also a cop, and we know how that turned out. Guys, any thoughts on Glenn? I think we covered it pretty well. I mean, he's going to crash, and he's going to be very entertaining. I think there's a very slim chance, though, he wins this game, right? Does anyone disagree?
Well, if you give him a Tyler Perry idol, and then, you know.
Exactly. Jordan, you never know. Slim to none, and Slim just left town. He ain't winning Big Brother.
Okay, all right, so let's continue with this. Okay, so Glenn is off the board here. And I think Glenn was not technically the highest person on my board, but I don't really like the highest person on my board, so I'm not going to take him. So I'll leave him for you. I'll leave him for you, Brent, if you want him. I'm just going to go way off the rails here because I've never just tried the crazy strategy, so I'm just going to go crazy with my next pick. This person is easily, like, on paper, the worst player this season.
Oh, you're not going to do
it. It's not even close. But she's feisty. She's entertaining. I really enjoyed her video. And she's the princess that was promised. She's going to give us an all-girls alliance. I'm going to take Natalie. I don't know how you say her last name. Negrotti? Is that how you say her name? I don't know. Something like that. So Natalie is who I'm going to take. She's, you know, we've got a great track record of Natalie's on this show.
And princesses.
Yes, we do. So I figured, why not take Natalie? She's going to be out week two, right, guys? There's probably no chance beyond that. I feel like she's friends with Pow Pow. She's going to go the same way. Because I don't know if you guys saw that. She had DJ Pow Lachey posted on, I think it was her Instagram or Twitter. She was like, oh, my gosh, didn't know Natalie was on the season. My BFF, good luck. So, I mean, even if she talked to Pow Pow, I mean, she's not getting any help from that whatsoever. In fact, I would say getting advice from Pow Pow would hurt your game rather than help it, and she already didn't have much to work with. So, yeah, I mean, I hope Natalie proves me wrong. I hope she's feisty. I hope she's, you know, great in the competition. She seems to be athletic. But other than that, I mean, I don't really know. Is there anything else going for her, Brent?
Hey, Pow Pow can teach you how to spell Kaltoru during a competition like a boss, all
right? That is right.
Thank you. I forgot about that.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Oh, my gosh. Jeez.
Yeah, her last name is it's Negrati, so it's Natalie Negrati. She's feisty. This is the fun pick. You know, this is just a boom or bust pick. Like, if somehow, you know, she catches the trapeze bar and gets herself into a showman somehow, even though she says she's not going to do it, but I think there's a chance she could, because you don't look that pretty and get put in the Big Brother house and then not flirt with the boys a little bit. If she gets into a showman, she can go far, but she says she's not going to do it, so let's see what happens. Well, I like this pick. I think it's very fun.
I'm with you. I mean, how does this girl not get into showmance? I mean, the guys are going to want to be in a showmance with her because she's stunning. And, you know, she talked about, yeah, you know, I'm single as a Pringle, but, you know, she's been pretty open to that idea. Taryn, who could you see Natalie ending up in a showmance with?
Any of the guys. I mean,
any of them? Not Jose.
Well, any within reason, Jordan. Come on.
But it's gonna happen.
Honestly, I could see her getting, as Brent said, I could see her getting together with Jose and, you know, them kind of buddy-buddying. But yeah, I mean, she's if she really tries this all-girl alliance thing, she is gone. Week one, week two. I mean, that's just the bottom line. Maybe if she gets into a showmance, she gets dragged for a while. The showmance goes, she starts playing her own game, wins a couple competitions, and then, you know, ends up a final two go. I don't know. That's maybe her best shot. But, yeah, I mean, apparently you've hired Becky to make your picks for you because you're completely team train wreck right now.
Yeah, if we're shooting for Victoria upside, I think we're really aiming low at this point before the season starts.
Oh yeah, no, I just figured go to my bread and butter, just throw it. We figured I'd do that. It worked well for me on Big Brother Canada. Okay, let's keep it moving. Brent, you've got the second pick of the third round, the last round of the new players. Only three people left. Who do you want to take?
Wow, there are some slim pickings in this part of the draft, let me tell
you. But you know what? I did you a favor. I got rid of Glenn and Natalie for you, so yeah, it should help you.
It's like taking the old maid out of your hand.
Exactly.
Well, there's somebody who bores me. There's somebody who doesn't excite me. And then there's somebody who's at least a little pretty to look at. So I'm going to go with him. Let's go with Corey Brooks. My friends, it's the Clay lookalike, the baseball coach who, like, it seems like in every interview he does, he talks about sports or some team or Texas A&M or something like that. He's just a tall drink of water, as I once called Paulie. I didn't realize how tall this guy was. Like Paulie's like 6 feet tall, 6 feet one, like I am. Corey is like 6'6", 6'7". Like, he's absolutely massive. Like, I can't believe that somebody like he's like Brendan in the house. He's absolutely huge. You know, obviously I'm foreseeing that he's going to get into some sort of a bromance or a bro alliance, a la the Bomb Squad or
bro
something
picks.
Like that.
Bro picks. Right.
There was something I wanted to bring up about, and this really doesn't have anything to do with the draft, but, you know, some people have been really, really hard on Corey for some things that he said on social media. He used a few homophobic slurs on social media, and as a member of the LGBT community, I would just like to say I was not offended by anything that he wrote. First of all, people say things when they're not being watched all the time. That doesn't excuse it. But I also think that this is a typical example of a straight guy who uses terms out of ignorance. And it's certainly not out of hate. I think a lot of people were hating on him. Like, you know, we want him evicted first. He's a mean human being. That's not true. We don't know anything about this guy whatsoever, so let's get to know him a little bit first, and then we can judge him, okay? But, you know, judging him for a few random posts he might have forgot to delete on Twitter, I think is really unfair. Again, it's up to us to teach people like Corey that it's not okay to say those words and that those words hurt and that they have meaning. But that doesn't mean that he's a hater or a homophobe. It's just not true. So please don't assign that category to him when we don't really know anything about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm co-sign that, Brent. We got to preach love. I mean, we got to teach him that that's not right. I mean, and certainly that is not right. That really turned me off, but with that, which is why, you know, I had him highest on my board that last term, but I did not want to take him because of that. But at the same time, you know, I co-sign what you said. So, I mean, not really for me to say. Brent, you are our representative of
I don't presume to speak for the entire gay community. I'm just saying that from what I saw, I did not see any animosity in those words when he tweeted them whatsoever. It was just it's like when people used to say that's so gay, as in that's so weird, that's how it felt to me. Like he was just using a homophobic slur for the word weirdo. And although that's not cool, but there's no hate behind it. And that's why I think he was getting a little bit of a raw deal from people.
Yeah, I think definitely, like, if you want to have the conversation that he's dumb for saying what he said, that he's dumb for not deleting his past history,
yes,
certainly that's an argument we can entertain. Certainly that's a conversation that can be had. If we want to go beyond that in terms of, like, reading into his intent or, like, what's in his heart, I don't think we have enough information yet. Let's meet this guy first. I totally am with Brent.
Yeah, let's give him a chance. We'll see what he's like once those feeds turn on. He's a boring guy, Taryn, just like you. Does that mean you like him or do you not?
He is altogether a different kind of boring. I am an awesome kind of boring. He is just a dull kind of boring. I couldn't even listen to him when he was talking. I don't even know anything about this guy because, as Brent said, he just talked about sports the whole time, and I just drowned it out. I couldn't even listen.
Yeah, and for you sports fans, he's apparently best friends with Ross Stripling on the LA Dodgers, pitcher, so that's kind of cool. But otherwise,
now JP's talking about stuff and I can't even hear him.
So there we go. Also, Taryn, you're not boring. I'm just it's a joke, okay?
You could be a Dodgers fan and not have heard of Ross Stripling.
That is true. I am a Dodgers fan. I know who Ross Stripling is. But Alex, any
gibberish to me.
any final thoughts on Corey, Alex, or can we move on? This guy's, as we said, not really too much there.
I think we're going to get, you know, what's the day for the hammock room where they take all the picks? Is that Thursday? It's during the day before the live show, right? That they have, room that they go in and take all the hangar room. Yeah. There's going to be a lot of sick bro picks this summer, Jordan. That's where I'm going with this.
Sick bro picks.
Sick bro picks are coming.
He's a big dude. He could get into an alliance. He could go far, but I don't really see him winning this game, especially with his lack of knowledge. Probably going to be Clay-esque, if you ask me. Yeah, okay, let's keep things rolling on. Taryn, second last pick of the newbies. Who you got?
It's a tough one.
Oh, come on.
You know, because I was very high on Bridget after the Jeff interview. However, the more I hear from Bridget, the less high I am on her.
Yeah, no.
I think the biggest problem I have with Victor is his hair. It's just too...
Wait, what?
Too ridiculous. You can't have that hair.
Here?
I'm taking Victor.
He's taking Victor! Oh, even
hair
though that...
Damn.
So what's okay? So Taryn, what's wrong with hair? Like he's just got long hair. There's nothing wrong with that.
He looks like.
How dare you judge
someone?
You're
not Jon Snow, bro.
In the same way that Paul looks very different, Victor looks like somebody who's trying to get something out of you. He looks like a real estate agent, a used car salesman. He just looks sleazy. And that's not going to be good for him. I think that Based on his bio, he certainly was a pretty sleazy guy. I don't know if he's the same person anymore. He kind of talked about, like, oh, I wrote that bio a long time ago. You know, it was funny. Maybe he's kind of like a more casual. Maybe he can integrate himself in the house, but that hair is just always going to paint a target on his back.
I don't know if you guys have seen it, but somebody posted today on Reddit, there's like this house music yes. video where it's like a bunch of, the whole music video is like a bunch of kids playing soccer in the street, and Victor is like the 80s movie villain of this movie music video, where he's like, he's not picking the main character for the team, and the main character, he's like taking shots and scoring on him and being a douche about it, and then the guy like goes home and he comes back the next day and all of a sudden he's like channeled Pele or something, he's really good, and now Victor's like getting embarrassed and he's the guy getting left face down in the mud and like, you know, like all pissed off about it. So yeah, Victor's like, his initial foray into you know, entertainment was as the douche. I don't know that, like, that's what not to expect from him this season, you know what I mean? Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I think Victor will be entertaining. It might be a little cringeworthy. I could see maybe, you know, early BB16 Beast Mode Cowboy in him, maybe just a little bit. I don't know. Yeah, Brent, it is a high bar. Any final thoughts on Victor, Brent?
Wow, I really don't know anything about this guy whatsoever. I mean, I watched that same video that they're talking about, but he looks very fun there. So if he has that sort of energy in the house, then he could go far. I mean, maybe, you know, stranger things have happened. Hello, I'm looking at you, Big Brother 11.
I just love I love Taryn's used car salesman comparison because it reminded me of it's like an episode of Futurama, I think, where they're buying a car from a guy named Victor and he's like a total grease ball. And then at the end, when he like upsells them on something, he walks away. He's like, hey, no dog food for Victor tonight, because he did such a good job that they're gonna feed him a real meal. So like, that's forever gonna be synonymous with this guy now. So thank you for that.
Wow.
No dog food for Victor tonight.
What a reference by Alex Kidwell. Wow, Futurama. I haven't seen Futurama in so long. Alex. Yeah, that's great. Alex, okay, since you left us with that great end on Victor, we'll just transition to you talking about Bridget. How are you feeling about Bridget being on your team? She's last of the newbies. I think she was last on my board. Is that where you had her? Were you higher on her? what's your thoughts on Bridget?
In a word, stuck, Jordan. I'm feeling stuck with Bridget. I don't know. I mean, you know, I like with the initial Jeff interview, she's not last on my list, although she's close to the bottom, just because she strikes me as someone that doesn't really, like, if you're going to put them on, rank them on who knows most what they're getting into. I don't think Bridget's high on that list. She seems to, like, you know, she's optimistic, and, you know, God love her for trying, and, you know, she's going to put her best foot forward, but I see this girl as being very possibly Joey Van Pelt, you know what I mean? Like, I'm going to go in there and, you know, make moves the way I've seen other people make moves, and it's just not, like, that's not how it's supposed to go.
I'm going
to
show everyone that you can play the game with integrity and not lie.
Good luck with that.
I haven't seen what you guys have seen. Apparently, this is the one I missed. So, what have you seen that's lowered your opinion so drastically on Bridget since we did the rankings podcast?
It was a lot of the I want to reinvent the wheel and go into this game. Basically, the first time I saw her, it was kind of like I was seeing the personality of Meg with a little bit of the strategic chops of Helen. And I thought, this might be a good combination. This might be a good player. Then the more I saw of her, I realized it was more the personality of Helen and the strategic chops of Meg, which is basically the opposite of everything that you want.
That's awesome. Yeah, she totally has that Helen enthusiasm.
Meg told us many, many times last year that Vanessa was not in alliance with Austin and the twins. Many times she said, I know it's not true. Like, there's no way that could be happening.
No way! It's not happening! Oh, man. Meg is so nice.
Why having her personality would be great.
Yeah, it really would have been. And for you guys, like, I was listening to that the preview you guys did with Rob, and you were talking about how Bronte's voice was so annoying. Something about Bridget's laugh or something, like, she seemed fake. I don't know what it was, but even in that big Jeff interview, I just did not get a good vibe from her whatsoever. So not really feeling good about Bridget. Wes Sutton in the chat was saying that if I really want to tank my team, Alex, I should trade you my last vet pick for Bridget, but I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that.
Yeah, man, if you're really throwing this competition. See, that's your problem, Jordan. You can't commit all the way.
No, well, I can't. Well, here's what I'm doing. Here's what I'm doing. I'm taking people that I like, and I don't care if I think they're going to be good or not. I don't really like Bridget, and I think I am going to like the person I end up with in the returnee round that we're going to do, which, you know what, let's just get right into it, speaking of that. So if you do not want to know who the rumored returning players are for Big Brother 18, we will bid you farewell. Thank you for joining us. We will be back live again next Monday night and throughout the rest of the Big Brother 18 season in this time slot, 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern, and we will be talking about everything that's going on about the live feed. So no episode talk. It's just the live feed correspondents and I. We're going to be talking about what's going on in the feed, stuff that doesn't necessarily get talked about on the main feed on RHAP, so we can get everybody a good grasp about what's actually really going on in the house, and we can get these guys to put their brains together. I think it'll be a really fun show, and I can't wait to get into it. Okay, spoiler time. Here we go. Returning round. Okay, so the returning players, if you have not heard, it's rumored that they are Nicole Franzel from Big Brother 16, Frank Udy from Big Brother 14, Davon Rogers from Big Brother 17, and James Hewling, also from Big Brother 17. Now, there was initially a report that these players were going to be coaches. We do not know that for a fact. We don't really have much information in terms of what they're going to be doing this season. We're assuming they're players. I would imagine that they are. The one thing that I'm not sure about is, guys, I mentioned earlier that it was announced that Battle of the Block is not happening this season, but instead a new competition will be replacing it on Sunday nights. So maybe that has something to do with it. So before we even get into it, do you guys have any ideas? Alex, I saw you tweeted today. Someone tweeted you asking what you think the Sunday night comp could be. What do you think?
Yeah, so I responded just, you know, with kind of a reasonable guess that I think makes a lot of sense, which is, you know, this, you know, based on what we know, which is that as far, my understanding is this comp is still going to fall between the head of household comp and the POV, so that it takes place sometime during that bulk of the strategic week. So my guess is it would be something, you know, I've heard people speculate maybe it could be like something to do with like playing for the right to have a vote that week, but that seems tough because like wouldn't everyone have to win but like the last two finishers or something like that? I don't know. I mean, that's possible. I think the most likely scenario is some kind of immunity competition. If you're not head of household, maybe it's a draw, maybe it's everybody. It seems less likely it's everybody. It seems like, yeah, maybe there'd be some kind of a draw where people would get a chance to compete for safety. You know what I mean? Whereby right. you're not in any kind of power position, but you're also not eligible to go on the block.
Yeah, I think the immunity thing would make sense, especially if Grodner and co. Actually, I won't really go down that rabbit hole, but I just think it would make sense. Okay. So
I'm still not a fan of the immunity thing, though, because I just feel like it's too similar to the veto. You know, I feel like, again, it's like the same episode twice in a row. This person needs safety. Do they get it? Yeah. No. This person needs safety. Do they win the veto? You know what I mean?
Well, it's like, they really want a comp for every day, but the game engine is good. Like I get that people don't love the food comps because there's not a lot of stakes there, but not everything needs to have stakes attached, really, does it?
Yeah, and another thing that I should add is that it was said that this competition is nothing that they've done before. So the chances of this being coaches, I think, is pretty slim, given that they've said this is something we've never done before. It's probably not a coaches competition. It's probably something different. They're probably not coaches, as far as I'm concerned.
One thing I was positing was that I thought there was a possibility that since we know there's going to be one head of household, thank God, thank you, Big Brother, only one head of household. But maybe that person has to nominate, like, three people. Or maybe they have to nominate them in pairs or something. I don't know. There's something where Al Grodner on Twitter or in some interview said that the competition is going to have some heavy stakes. I keep saying now. All I can think about is like steaks and A1 and food and all that sort of thing.
Oh, spoiler alert! I'm having steak. I'm having steak for dinner tonight. So you're making me very hungry.
I don't know why. It's so crazy. But no, I think that it's possible. Like, I'm going with that. The head of household is going to nominate three people, and those three people get to play a competition to be immune for the rest of the week.
Of the block.
Yeah.
See, I could see,
at least one head of household only.
We'll get into the picks in a sec. I was just going to say, I could see the four returnees being captains and having something similar to, like, the Clicks twist from BB11, and then having, instead of a coaches competition, a captains competition, and one of them, if they win, they can protect someone on their team. I don't know what it is, but...
There has been speculation about teams. They were wearing certain colors in the interview, stuff like that. So that's certainly a possibility.
Yeah, so we'll see you come Wednesday night. I'm excited either way. I think we're all going to watch. It'll be fun to finally figure out what exactly is the twist with these returnees this season. But enough chatter. Let's get into the picks because I want to go eat my steak. So Alex, you've got the first pick out of the returning players. Who do you want to take?
I will take Psycho Sid's son himself, Beast Mode Carrot Top, Frank Udy.
Frank the Tank, wow! And Taryn is so happy, he's overjoyed that Frank...
My strategy paid off yet again.
Yeah, well, he's happy now. Just wait until Frank comes back in, having completed the Mike Boogie crash course of how to actually play this game well and be the alpha of the Chilltown duo. You know, he's only been the beta. I think he comes back and makes Corey his beta. There's a lot of guys in this house that would, chop off their hand to bro down with Frank, I think. There's a lot to like here if you're Frank Udy. All he's got to do is rein in the, standing up push-ups against the wall while everyone's watching. Dial that back a bit, dude. That's too much. Some of the things he did that just made himself an overt target he didn't need to do. If he could just dial some of that back, kind of rein it in, be chill, be sociable, not be Frank against the world. Obviously, he was kind of put in that position early on in his season, but if he can find a way to be in a middle ground, which he never was, he was always either on the block or in power, if he could ever find any kind of middle position, like, man, that's insane. Because look what this guy was able to do with nothing, right?
Yeah, and quickly, just the stats for Frank. So Frank was on Big Brother 14 for the uninitiated. He finished in 7th place. He had 3 HOH wins, 3 power veto wins. He was nominated 6 times, and he has a nomination percentage of 100. So every single time Frank could have gone on the block, he went on the block. And he still lasted for 8 weeks, so understandable why they asked him back and understandable why he won America's Favorite House Guest, because he got a lot of airtime. Personally, I think I'm buying what you're selling there, Alex. I think that Frank will step it up even more, though. I think he's just going to go brogade style of alliance. I think he's just going to surround himself with big dudes because he doesn't want to be perceived as the only big threat in the house, and he's going to try and parlay that into going deep into the game. Taryn, I know you are not a big fan of Frank. Do you think that there's – I mean, even with all that stuff, though, I still don't think he can win the game. Do you think he can win this game?
Well, here's why I'm so glad that Alex took Frank, because I did not want to have to take Frank. I did not want to have Frank on my team, and he would have been on my team had Alex picked the other person that's going to be, I'm assuming, would have been his second pick. Well, you never know. But yeah, I think that Frank, this is a great setup for Frank. He's coming back. He's the oldest. He's from the oldest season of the returning players. Nobody's going to know him. There aren't any big fans here. They're going to know him as, like, a personality more than a player. This is the spot that Rachel came back and won in, basically. So, you know, with that as the archetype, I think that Frank perfectly fits it, right? Like, he can win a bunch of competitions, he can get along with the bros, people are going to look up to him because he's a returning player, and his dad is a professional wrestler, and he's set up so well. I can see him going very far and having a very decent shot just based on the fact that he's a returning player. But I still think he's a terrible player, and I don't want to see him do well, so I'm glad he's not on my team.
And for those of you who do not know, Taryn is not a fan of Frank because he was a bitter jury member against Dan in Big Brother 14, and Taryn is the biggest Dan super fan in the world.
I hate all bitter jury members equally.
Okay, but Frank in particular.
Okay. I wouldn't say so.
Hey, anyone who would have voted for a bottle of ketchup, I think you have to question that guy's judgment, right?
Yeah, and he to this day defends his decision. And last season, he thought Liz deserved to win in the final three.
Well,
Liz,
in fairness,
he's not on the jury for anyone this year.
in fairness to Frank, as a jury member, it's his right to vote for who he wants to vote for.
Yeah, it's my right to judge him for it.
Yeah, but you know what? At the same time, Dan, I mean, if you had Dan do that, and this is another podcast, but if you had Dan do that to you personally.
Not voting Danielle.
Okay, but Tara, not every. Anyway, this is gonna just.
I judge you for not voting Godfrey.
But I wasn't. Okay, again, this is going way off the rails. I agree. Godfrey should have won. But
you were wrong in your vote, Jordan.
I mean, Sarah played great, but I love Godfrey so much. Anyway, this is a different conversation. We're going way off track. Brent, I need to ask you this.
Yes.
What is Frank's biggest flaw? What's the biggest thing he's got to work on in order for him to have a chance of winning this time around?
He needs to be willing to get his hands dirty. I think that's what he needs. He played the game way too honest last time, way too trusting, way too naive, you know, and really held it against people when they lied to him. I remember watching him with Brittany in the jury house, and she's like, well, you know, if you're going to play Susie High Horse, then that's your right, but we're playing Big Brother. And so I'm hoping that he's not playing Susie High Horse this time. I'm hoping that he's actually coming to play Big Brother. You know he talked to Boogie. You know he talked to a few other people. I'm sure they've told him what we're telling him right now, which is just tone down the physicality a little bit. Be willing to cut a few people's throats if you need to. It's okay to lie in the Big Brother house. And that's what he didn't seem to wrap his head around when he was there the first time. Because he said he was an honest kind of guy. He couldn't see. He's one of these people that Taryn and I can't stand, and I'm sure Alex and you guys and you, Jordan, to a certain extent, who they lie to people or they do things that are probably dishonest on their face, but then other people lie to them and they say, well, I never lied to you. I never did this. And, you know, clearly they did. Clearly they did lie. They just don't remember their own lies, or they have lied so much that they start to believe their own lies. So I'm hoping that he has grown as a player, but I'm not exactly optimistic.
I want to give a shout-out to the Dom and Colin podcast. They did a really good draft just the other day, and they had Ian Terry on, and Ian obviously played with Frank. And it was cool, you know, hearing a little bit from Ian about kind of some insight into Frank's game. And I think one thing that really stuck with me is that Ian talked about how Frank views the Big Brother house the way an athlete views the field or the court. Yes. You know what I mean? And that Frank, it's hard for Frank, like he wants to, you know, the way Jeff talked about it in Big Brother 11, I want to draw lines and let's go to war. You know what I mean? He wants to know who his enemy is and then prepare for battle. And that's just not really what this game is. This game is knives in the dark. You know what I mean? This game is getting shanked from behind. Like, I understand wanting it to be that, but that's not what it is. So Frank needs to find – his biggest obstacle is going to be rationalizing that and coming to terms with the fact that you can't just say, you're my enemy and that's the way it is. You need to be able to work with everyone, keep your options open. Like, Ian even talked about how Frank would have distaste for Ian playing pool with Dan. Like, you need to be able to just keep social roads open for the possibility of – if you need to work with that person down the road, you can't have alienated them completely by being a douche. So that's what he's got to overcome.
Yeah, check that out. Shout out to Dom and Colin. Great podcast. If you are a Big Brother fan, they have a great BB18 preview up there with Ian. So check it out if you haven't already. Let's go to you, Taryn. You've got the second pick in the returning player round, and I think everybody knows where you're going to go, but I'll let you announce the pick.
Yeah, this is probably my number two or three pick overall. I think that this person is somebody who did not do particularly well in their first game, but they probably did better than most people on that season. I think that she's coming back with a lot of extra knowledge that she can put into effect. She's going to be underestimated. I think Nicole is going to have a very good chance of winning this game.
Nicole Franzel, BB16, just looking at the stats here. So Nicole, also like Frank, finished in 7th, had 3 HOH wins, but that was a Battle of the Block season, so she was dethroned twice. She did not win the power veto at all, and she was evicted twice, nominated 6 times, evicted twice, once in week 8, and then again in week 10. Taryn, I feel like, you know, for me, Nicole, I'm with you. I think that Nicole was very high on my list. If we would have just had an open forum with the picks, Nicole would have been number one. I would have taken her first just because Nicole is one of my favorites ever. I just love her. She's awesome. Here's the thing with Nicole too, not threatening and super likable, and also gets the game. I think that those three things are going to go very far for her, and I think that that's a very good pick by you, man. I don't really have anything else to say. I mean, do you think that you know she's, because something that, you know, put a target on her back the first time around was that she knew too much about Derek. There is no Derek this season. But I also think the showmance thing, I think that kind of put a target on her back a little bit. I think from what I have heard in my circles, her and Hayden are no longer a thing. So, Taryn, do you think that a showmance would hurt her game? And do you think she's going to end up in one?
I don't think she will. I think she probably learned her lesson from the last time. I don't think that any of the guys on this cast are probably her type. Basically, when I look at Nicole, she is somebody who, she was on to Derek in a way that almost nobody was. She saw through him. If it wasn't for Cody having a good relationship, she wasn't able to see through Cody. Cody got her and Hayden to trust Derek. They went with them. And again, Derek almost made the decision to go with Nicole and Hayden instead of Zach and Frankie and the rest of the bomb squad and the detonators. He changed his mind at the last minute because Caleb reminded him, like, hey, I'm really dumb and loyal. Basically.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. He's dumb and loyal. Why are we doing this?
He came very close to being in a decent position here. My biggest issue with Nicole is that when she came back into the game, she had a ton of information that she did not utilize properly. I'm hoping that she's learned her lesson. This third chance that she has, she's going to have a ton of information about how she should play this game. She is the Jordan Lloyd that knows the game. I think that that is very dangerous, and I think that people are going to underestimate her. So with all of that said, and she's pretty good at the competitions too. So I really think that she is one of the best shots this season.
Yeah, I'm really feeling Nicole. I think she's going to do well. Brent, Brent, I'll go to you in a sec. Alex, why did you take Frank over Nicole? Because I feel like Nicole, she's definitely going to go far in this game. I don't think anybody's questioning that.
Yeah, they have different obstacles to overcome. I think Nicole is much more likely to go far. I think Frank, if he finds himself at the end, is more likely to win. I like Frank's ability to win a given competition to save himself in pretty much any scenario, which is a good thing to have for a player you're picking in a draft. Frank, like I said, he has to overcome being too aggressive. Nicole, it's the opposite. She has to find that switch. She has to learn to be aggressive and to put herself before other people in this game, or she's not going to be able to win. That's the gear that she didn't have for me last time, and that she was always thinking about not what's best for Nicole to win this game, but like what makes sense for Nicole, for Hayden, for Chris. Like, she's trying to protect everyone and she's trying to take care of everyone, and it's that kind of like, you know, camaraderie that makes people like you in the house, but it's also that kind of like team mentality that gets you axed by someone who's looking out for themselves. So that's what she's going to have to overcome. I don't think she won't be able to do it. I just think that, you know, there's always going to be the possibility that she's more willing to take care of someone than they are of her, and that opens up the door for you to be the one who gets got before you get somebody.
All right, Brent, let me ask you this. Out of the returning players, who do you think Nicole is going to be the tightest with? Who's she going to work with, at least from what you've seen, if this is the correct crew? And from the newbies, is there anyone in particular you could see Nicole bonding with? Brent, did we lose Brent?
Is he frozen? I think he might be frozen.
I think Brent is frozen. Okay, so Brent is out, so I'll throw that to you, Taryn. But we just got blindsided. Out of the returning players, who do you think Nicole will be the closest with?
I think that she's going to recognize that she should buddy up with Frank because he's always going to be a target over her. I think that she... I think that she can easily get James if she wants. James is such a sucker for any kind of cute girl that's going to give him attention. So she could be his Meg. And she might have a little trouble with Devon. I think Devon is kind of... She's smart about this. She's going to see Nicole and be like, you're too good for this. Like, I'm not going to buddy up with you because you're too sweet.
You did better than 16th. What is this?
Yeah, she's... Devon is going to want like a Jason, she's going to want like a Michelle, she's going to want somebody a little more feisty, so I'm not sure she's going to hook up with her as much, but I do think that she's going to want to bond with those guys, and I think that she, she that's a great move for her.
All right, let's keep it going. Two more picks left. Brent, please leave me with the person that I want. Please.
I will. I don't know if you know, but I fell off for a second because of my wireless. So I want to get this in while I still have a signal. I'm picking Davon. So there you go. I hope that makes you happy.
No, that's what I wanted. No,
you think you wanted James?
I really?
Didn't want James. I wanted Davon.
You thought he was banking on the guy that can't pronounce sequester?
Well, I just texted you. I said, look, I got booted, wireless acting up. I'm picking Davon, trying to log back in. So, you know, if I hadn't logged back in, you probably could have beat me to it. But
Jordan's taking Davon. Getting worse.
This is a hoping change pick. I'm hoping that she changes and she can go far in the game. I don't really have a lot of evidence to think that she can do this, but she's somebody who I would just love to see go far in Big Brother. So I'm kind of like, I'm like JP. I'm picking somebody that I like. I really don't care for James all that much. He's a sweet guy, you know, whatever. But he's never really been my cup of tea. Whereas Davon, I love me some Davon. So, like, I hope she can pull something out of her hat here.
I love Davon, which is why I'm so mad, because I would have had a full team of people that I just love.
Nothing against.
Now it's just mostly love and all train wreck.
Exactly.
Well, don't worry, Jordan. On Wednesday night, they're going to announce that the big twist is that the winner of this season is the person who can most successfully jump out of closets and scare people. So your winner equity is going to go through the roof.
Yay, because that's a skill.
Yeah, that definitely is a skill. Okay, so Davon, interesting here. Can Davon improve, guys? I mean, I feel like she has to, right? 16th, she can't do any worse than that. So she's going to at least do the same as what she did last time. We've never had a returning player finish this far back in a season ever. But Davon is awesome. That's why CBS is bringing her back, and I applaud this decision. I think she's going to be excellent television. Let's go around quickly. Taryn, percent chance that Davon makes it to the jury?
I mean, just on returning player status alone, I think she's got, you know, like a 20% chance at least. I think, but my problem with Davon, as far as her chances of improving, just the way that I've seen her talk about the game after the game, it doesn't seem like she really learned a whole lot. Seems like she's still very much in the same mindset that got her evicted in the first place. So I'm not super confident that she's going to improve much, but she's going in under different circumstances. And under those circumstances, she has a little more power. She has a little more room to play around with that kind of feistiness. So I think she could last a bit longer than she did last time.
You know, Tara makes a good point, actually, in that, like, what would Davon think she needs to change? You know, like, granted she did bad in the game, but then CBS brought her back for The Price is Right, and CBS has had her on all this stuff, and CBS is pushing her, and CBS is bringing her back for the very next season, and, like, you know, in many ways, that's, like, affirming everything she did in the house as correct, you know what I mean? Like, even if it was terrible, even if you use that Kathleen Griffin twist the worst way it could possibly be used, CBS rewarded you for it all. You know what I mean? So, like, that is, it's like, you know, when you keep giving somebody rewards, they think they're doing something correctly, you know? And, yeah, that's a concern.
Odds she makes it to the jury, Alex?
To the jury? I mean, well, what is it now? Like, easily half the cast makes it that far, right?
Right.
Like,
yep.
So, just based on that alone, yeah. I mean, so, yeah, if, like, 66% is, like, the default, I think, I don't know. It's pretty good. I mean, I think, you know, she won't really have to, you know, it'll be probably more like the BB14 thing where it's like, you know, 7 or, you know, around there is when you start to see, you know, the returnees turn on each other, assuming they all get there. Either they're all going to go out in quick fashion or they're all going to be there, I think. So I would say it's probably somewhere around like maybe 76%. I don't know. Something.
Yeah. Oh, wow. 76%. Wow. That's very good for being that exact. Yes.
I don't like to round it off.
No. Brent, we'll end off with Davon on this. For whatever reason, I just feel like Davon, just based on that Clay fight, and again, we talked about that yesterday on our top 10 worst moves in Big Brother history podcast. I feel like Davon is going to get in. She's going to fight with the vets. I feel like she's going to, or the newbies, one or the other, but she's going to fight with somebody. Do you think that she is going to, like, what do you think we're going to see? Like, what's okay. the narrative from Dave Vaughn we're going to see this season?
Here's the thing. I honestly do believe that a lot of the stuff that she said in interviews after the fact about how she's like, you know, I had to go off on him and I had to get into this and I had to say this. I think a lot of that is just her being fun and having fun with the interviewers and trying to get her personality out there because, you know, she did go out second. She wants people to remember her. So that was her big moment on the show. I'm hoping that she's very much like Lex in All Stars when she goes back and says, you know, the first time was for fun, for the experience, but the second time, this is business, and I have to get my act together, and I can't do stuff like that anymore. So hoping that she's able to do that, and she's able to not fight with people, hold her tongue when she needs to. And, you know, as a vet, again, I'm with the other boys on this, that I think that she has just equity based on that alone. I really don't think they're going to come for her in that way. So unless she really tries hard to get herself in a fight with somebody, I like her chances of going far in this game. I really do.
I think when you said you hoped that she'd be like Lex on All Stars, I was like, what, you want her to be like a little crybaby? I don't understand. Oh, okay.
Shame.
I was going to say, I think this cast is a little more conducive to her, too. I don't know if it's like... You just don't naturally see someone like Dave Vaughn just insta-gelling with someone like a Johnny Mac. Whereas, like, there's a lot of girls this season that seems like they're, you know, like, they you could see them sitting around and, you know, just you know, running and through the shade with Dave Vaughn.
And there's no blondes. You know, there's no pretty little white blonde girls in this entire cast.
Nicole. Not a thickums in sight.
Nicole, of course. Besides Nicole, but she's a vet, right? So all these girls, there's a lot of people of color in this cast. There's a lot of people that look more like Davon who, you know, aren't from, like, you know, the middle of Kansas. So I'm hoping that she can identify with some of these people a little
bit more. Kansas shade.
Oh, you know, I'm just picking, like, or Indiana, for that matter. Whatever, I'm from
Texas
Indiana.
Texas A&M.
So, now Indiana! There's not a bunch of white people, is what I'm saying. There's not a bunch of white, straight people in the house. There's people from other ethnicities. There's other people from other sexualities. I hope she can have a sense of camaraderie with these people, where I felt like the first time she played Big Brother, I really felt like she was fighting against the rest of the house. Like, she didn't trust any of them.
Wait, which has there been more, Big Brother players from Indiana or Big Brother players from Clay's baseball team?
Oh, wow. Well, we've got two.
We're up to two.
Think about that one.
Yeah, wow. That's we'll have to do some research on that. Yeah. Okay. And quickly, everybody, if you're listening to this, please, let's all together tonight pray to the BB gods that Dave Vaughn goes far on this season. Because
yes.
I think that if we get Dave Vaughn going far, this will be a great season.
By the way, and before you tell everybody your last pick, and we all know who it is, I have a question for you guys that I want to ask you at the end. But we'll save that to the end. So just stick around to the podcast because I want to ask you.
And we'll ask that at the end. Okay.
All right.
All right, so my pick is James, by default. I thought I was going to get Dave Vaughn, because she finished 16th, but no, I get James. I mean, James is a perfectly nice guy.
He loves blood, Jordan.
I love blood, I'm going to wear a lot of war paint, you know. Just something, you know, here's the thing with James that troubles me with having him. You know, he comes out of 17 as, you know, America's favorite player. Everybody loves him. He gets all this attention, all this great stuff. But, you know, his cast has really turned on him a lot, at least from what I have heard, at least from what I have seen on social media. It doesn't seem like he's very popular amongst them. So that makes me wonder, okay, has there been a change in James since the show? Has his ego grown a little bit? Has something, like, what is the difference? Because he was very popular when he was in there, and now for whatever reason they've all turned on him. I don't know what the reason is. So that concerns me a little bit with him. And I'm also scared that, you know, he is, you know, fresh off this season. He's fresh off of being America's favorite player. I'm scared that he is going to go in there and he is going to, you know, talk down to some of these newbies a little bit, and I think that might rub them the wrong way. Guys, what do you think about that?
Well, does Taryn or Alex know any of the tea about what's going on with James and why people don't like him as much as they used to?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay, well, let's hear it. Talk about it.
So, yeah, Taryn, did you watch the On the Block episode with Jason Roy
I didn't. I actually didn't watch that, no.
Okay, so, I checked out some of that. Jason, you know, obviously they got into James a little bit, and Jason has some insight having played with the guy, knowing, you know, at that point he's pretty much, you know, knowing that Dave Vaughn and Jason are going, or that Dave Vaughn and James are going back. You know, I don't want to, like, you know, paraphrase too much,
no,
for saying the wrong thing, but definitely, like, Jason describes James as being the kind of guy that, you know, the super fans get frustrated with. The guy that, like, wasn't maybe the biggest Big Brother fan ahead of time. Like, he had friends that were bigger fans than he was. But once he got in the house, now he's all about it. He's wearing his BB17 shirt every day. Jason said that, like, the first thing James asked him when they finished their rap party after the season was, so does this mean I can do another reality show now? Like, it sounds like there's a lot from, you know, from what Jason had reported that is like, you know, James trying to parlay this into bigger things for James. And, you know, then you top it off with, I've definitely seen some things on a few Facebook groups where it's like, just a little weird in terms of like requests made to fans or like, you know, just it's some weirdness in terms of the relationship there between James and James's like PR team, if you will, and like the BB fan base at large, whereby it's just rubbed a few people the wrong way. And then, you know, you top that overwhelmingly with the thing that everyone gets the most frustrated by, which is the idea that like someone from Big Brother is trying to get famous, which is not what you're supposed to be here to do, right? So, you know, that frustrates people like Jason, who are diehard fans of this show, who've wanted nothing but to play Big Brother their whole life. That someone like Jason, or that someone like James, could come in, be given this shot, not appreciate it anywhere near as much as Jason does. You know, be looking to parlay it into an opportunity to do literally anything else. I mean, Jason said he applied to Redneck Island first, which is not the show Big Brother is, not even close. So then, you know, I think all that compounded, and then just the knowledge that James is given the opportunity to return the very next year, it rubs some people the wrong way.
And let us not forget the whole Meg situation, where, you know, Meg and James are best friends on the season.
Yeah.
And then afterward, it seemed like James very much wanted, it's, you know, something more, and it was cute on the show, but apparently it didn't stay cute. Meg eventually kind of goes on to date some other people that you may or may not have heard of from Survivor. And James, not super happy about it, doesn't want to show up at her events, doesn't really want to tell her ahead of time, gets into lots of passive-aggressive shoutings on social media. Not a good look for anyone. And I mean, to be honest, this is something that I... Not to say that I think that James is a terrible person, but I was never really on the James train, even during Big Brother 17. He was very much playing up to the cameras. He knew what he was doing. You know, I think that he was very much going, like, all he cared about was being America's favorite player. He didn't even care about winning the game at a certain point. He was doing all of his antics on purpose in order to get camera time, in order to be America's favorite player. And that's why I gave my endorsement to J-Mac, because I felt like he was a better representative. But, you know, here we are. We're getting James back. I think that this is not going to be a good season for James. I think that both, you know, from the fan perspective and from a game perspective, I think this is just all downhill from here.
Really? I have to say, I'll take the minority view here. I don't really see anybody coming for James. Like, who's going to come for James in this cast? Really? Like, I mean, I know we kind of wish it that way, but I don't really see it happening. And, you know, the thing about him, like, trying to parlay this into something else, you know, he's not the first... Big Brother.
It's a very fair point. Yes,
to try to do that and have delusions of grandeur and
maybe
get a little bit too big for his, get a little bit too big for his britches. So, you know, I'm hoping that maybe he'll learn from this a little bit. Maybe he will. Maybe he won't. I don't know. But I'm not gonna throw shade on him for trying to, you know, better himself and his family and try to make something of himself when, you know, it doesn't. You know, he sounds like a pretty average American, and, you know, lives paycheck to paycheck, that sort of thing, and he's trying to make life better for himself and his daughter. So he's got a daughter. Remember that.
Yeah, and yes, I do want to say I would love to see James, you know, come into this situation thinking it's going to be one thing, and then when it doesn't really turn out to be that thing, kind of learning from that and kind of growing from that. And
right.
I'd love to see that happen. I'm not sure that it's going to, but right.
Last thing on James here quickly. I didn't talk about the stats for Davon because she didn't really have any because she was out so early. James also, like the other returnees though, Nicole and Frank, he also came in seventh place. It seems to be the money slot or spot for getting called back on an All-Star season. Had two HOH wins, two POV wins, nominated 5 times. Yeah, I don't really know if James showed a ton of, regardless of all this other stuff, I don't know if James showed a ton of strategic prowess, but again, like Brent said, I mean, other people have done that kind of stuff before. And yeah, unless he goes really hard at someone or turns on the vets right away, I think that, yeah, he can win competitions, and you know, I think he can go deep in this game. I just don't think he's got what it takes to win. Okay,
I
think James will be there for a long time. The reason I think that the fans will probably turn on him is that I think a large part of his appeal was his underdog status. If he's coming in as a returnee and he's part of a dominant alliance, I don't think that's going to be a good look for him.
That's true. Very good point. Like, remember early on in 17, right? He's with the guys, and then nobody's like clamoring for James. But then when he goes to the other side of the house, everyone's like, "Yeah, James! Oh yeah, it's awesome."
When he was Jeff's number two, nobody was like, "Yeah, I love James."
Exactly.
But yeah, I mean, now that we've run through them all, I think you make a good point when you touch on the stats, Jordan. That I think a big part of why people aren't as up in arms about this as they might be is that this isn't Derek and Vanessa coming in to just railroad a new player's cast. All four of these players made drastic mistakes, and there are things you can point to. Nicole got a second chance in her own season and wasn't able to do anything with it. James, like, decided at Final Eight that he was going to, you know, play competitions to win the rest of the way. Davon, I mean, you know, barely made it 2 weeks.
And then
Frank, you know, it's Frank versus the world the whole season. Frank voted twice the entire season, and both times he voted wrong. So with all four of these people, there's huge glaring errors to point to. Yes, they're coming in with an advantage, but it's not the advantage that it might be.
Brent, you said you had a question for the very end. So what would you like to ask?
What I want to ask is, who you guys think, when the feeds come on after Thursday night's show, or maybe like when we see what happens during Wednesday and Thursday's show, who is going to be the head of household and who is going to be the first target this season?
Hard question.
It's hard because we don't even know if the returnees are going to be a part of that.
Let's assume everybody's up for eviction. Everybody can go at any time. Who's going to be the first head of household, and who is going to be the first target, the first person who is targeted in Big Brother 18? I want to hear it. Alex, tell me.
Well, from a narrative perspective, Blake Hessler reminded me in the chat, and I would love to see this, that James is creepy with Vanessa's mom's picture in HOH.
Yes!
Fantastic, then. If Tiffany wins head of household, and James da-da-da-da-da makes his way up to the bedroom, and, oh, who is this fine-looking cougar? She looks familiar. Oh, hey, Mrs. Russo, how we doing?
That would be so good. I'm going to say first HOH. This is hard. I'm going to say that James is the first HOH. I'm going to say he's first HOH. And I'm going to say my homegirl, Natalie Negrotti, is the first target. Taryn, what do you think?
Taryn, if you want to think about it. I can say mine if you're still thinking.
Yeah, you can go ahead.
Okay, cool. I think that we're going to have a little more Russo-ness, so I think Tiffany is going to be your first head of household, and I'm going to say that she's going to align with the vets, and she's definitely going to go after a girl. I'm going to guess it's going to be Bridget. Bridget, girl, bye.
Yeah, I could see that. I could see that. Yeah, I could buy that. Alex, so you said that Tiffany's going to win, right? Who do you think is the target?
I hope it's James.
Okay.
Dude, you were just too... I'm sorry. Like, I just can't... You're too creepy with my mom, and I just... like, honestly, I need to put you on the block right now, so that's what's going to happen.
Okay. I think there's a very good chance that James wins it, actually. I think that he's both going to be trying for it, and they usually do some sort of endurance, which he's very good at. You know, I think Tiffany would also be good at it, but she did say she's going to try to throw, even though it might be hard for her. I think James is probably very likely to take it, and he will probably go after... I think he'll probably be Frank's number two, especially in the beginning. So who does Frank want to go after? Frank probably wants to go after either Tiffany or somebody like...
like a woman like he's threatened by.
Like a Natalie. Yeah.
Or Michelle, who might remind him of Ian, maybe.
Yeah.
It's probably a girl. Unless Paul comes out really strong and Paul reminds him of someone like Dan.
Paulie or Glenn? Which one?
Paul.
Yes.
Bearded guy. I think because, you know, Frank is not a fan of these people who think that they can be confident and play people. I think that he might see a little bit of Dan and Paul, but I also think he might be threatened by Natalie wanting a girls' alliance, and he might be threatened by Tiffany being Vanessa, not wanting Vanessa. Tiffany could also remind him of somebody like Dan, who's kind of a player. But it depends on if he wants to align himself with the siblings. I don't know if he's smart enough to realize he probably should. So, yeah, I'm probably going to say Natalie, just because it's probably the most likely. So, yeah, James and Natalie.
All right, we're on the same page, Taryn. Okay, well, I think with that, we are going to wrap this up. Thank you, everybody, for joining us on this preseason edition of the Reality TV Happy Hour. This was a lot of fun, guys. It's always a pleasure doing these shows with you. Can't wait to do another one next week. And I can't wait for Big Brother to start. We're almost here, guys. We got it's Monday night. It's on Wednesday night, so two more sleeps and we're there. So I'm really looking forward to this. Quickly, for the hashtag tonight, I was thinking we can each name our teams, and then people can tweet us with our respective hashtags. So I'm going to go with, and just to recap the teams, so my team is Michelle, Glenn, Natalie, and James. Brent is Jose, Bronte, Corey, and Davon. Taryn has Tiffany, Paul, Victor, and Nicole, and Alex has Zakia, Polly, Bridget, and Frank. So I think it's fitting I name my team Trainwreck or Team Becky. What do you guys think is more fitting?
Trainwreck.
I do like Becky.
Okay, fine.
Hashtag.
But, I mean, Trainwreck also works, right?
Hashtag Team Trainwreck. It is a train wreck. So if you like my team the most, tweet me using hashtag Team Trainwreck. I'm at Jordan Parhar. Taryn, what would you like to name your team?
Can you skip me?
All right, Taryn. Stop. Brent. I have mine already. So,
Brent,
yeah.
Your team.
I have two white people who are like white. And I have two people who are not white, who are people of color. I'm going to go with Team Cookies and Cream. Yay! I love it.
Team Cookies and Cream. Okay. Yes. I don't know if it's kosher, but maybe.
Oh, we can't do that? What?
I don't know.
Well,
I don't know.
It'll be kosher. Okay, well then, fine. So let's go with, how about black and white? Let's go with that. So Davon's black.
Let's go.
I love a girl of color. She looks
great.
She's
cookies
awesome.
And cream. That's just easier. I'm sorry. I just don't want Rob to get mad at me.
That's why.
Davon's entrance from last season was the snap clap. You could have gone Team Snap Clap.
Thank you. Forgot about that one. Yeah.
A good one.
Okay, let's just go with that. Hashtag Team Snap Clap.
All right, fine.
Brent is at One Lucky Gay. Tweet him if you like his team the most. Hashtag Team Snap Clap. Alex, we'll go to you. What do you want to name your team?
Oh, I just had one. Hashtag Beast Mode Calafiore. That's mine.
Beast Mode Calafiore. Hashtag Beast Mode Calafiore. Tweet Alex. He's at Alex Kidwell. Taryn, I've given you lots of time. What's your team? Otherwise, I'm going to name it for you.
All right. I think it has to be Team YOLO.
Team YOLO. All right. Awesome. You figured it out. Okay. So hashtag Team YOLO. Taryn is at Armstrong. Taryn. Okay, guys, thank you so much for joining us. If you want to support the show, a few ways you can do that. One, you go to robbiswebsite.com/happyhour. That's happy hour with an R at the front. And you can subscribe to the podcast while you're there. And once you click that link, it'll also give you an option to leave a rating and a review. If you could do that for us, it's really helpful. It helps the podcast grow. I think we'll be doing a rating and review contest again, like we did for Big Brother Canada 4. So if you want to leave a rating and a review, and if you haven't done so already, please do so, and your name will go into the hat for that draw at the end of that season. You'll get a Jordan Parhar-related prize. The second thing that you can do to support the show is to subscribe on YouTube. Go to Reality TV Wrap-Ups on YouTube. Subscribe there. You never miss any of our live broadcasts if you want to join the video version of this, and you can see all four of us in our glory. And it's always fun. I love doing these. So definitely, if you can subscribe, helps us out. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for joining us so much. Big Brother's right around the corner, and we cannot wait for it to get started. For Alex Kidwell, Taryn Armstrong, and Brent Waldgemut, I'm Jordan Parhar. I used a bunch of hashtags earlier, so just use one of those.
Team YOLO.
I already screwed up. Talk to you later. Thank you for joining us. Peace out.